for that report. And turning back now to politics, whether you're watching the nightly news or a repeat of Seinfeld, chances are you cannot escape hearing about the midterm elections. Well, that is because the flood of campaign ads consumes most commercial breaks. Nearly 3 million have aired so far this election cycle, and we still have 5 days to go. And those ads don't come cheap. Overall spending has already topped $1 billion with a B, people. Yikes. Now that money has to come from somewhere, and here's a hint. It is not from people like you or me. So is there any hope, even a sliver of hope, to get the average Joe back in the game? Well, there's a new bill floating around in Congress aimed to give small campaign donors a bigger voice in the process. It provides a tax credit for donors and allows matching money to candidates who agree to contribution limits and full transparency about who is funding their run. The bill was introduced by Congressman John Sarbanes, a Democrat from just outside the Beltway in Maryland. It is described as a bipartisan bill, but as of now, there is only one Republican signed on to it. Congressman, thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks so much for having me.
So I want to focus on this number one Republican signing on, because when you look at polling, you see that Republican voters and Democratic voters want this to change. They do not want big money dominating campaign cycles. So what has to happen to get more Republicans on board with this?
I think what's going to happen is you're going to have Republican constituents across the country in these districts where there are Republican members of Congress consistently saying this is an important issue for us. As you pointed out, the polling indicates that across the political spectrum, whether it's Democrats, independents, or Republicans, people are feeling left out. They feel that government works for somebody else, that it works for big money and special interests, and that the voices of everyday citizens are being left behind. That's a universal feeling. It's a deep sentiment. It's broad, and it's growing every single day. I think this narrative of taking our government back from special interests is something that's going to resonate across the political spectrum. And I think you will see in the future more Republican members of Congress hearing that message and getting behind reform like this.
Congressman, this bill is a fantastic idea. We've covered on the show a lot the problems with money in politics. You're right to say most people, when asked, would rather voters had a bigger say than billionaires or even corporations, right? But beyond this being a good idea, we all know members of Congress, they can slap their name on anything. Very few bills move. Those that do have to be a priority. And don't you think, as we look here towards Tuesday and the midterms, don't we need more people who are running specifically on this issue? I can think back to when Paul Wellstone or John McCain or Russ Feingold made cleaning up Washington and changing the money system their number one issue. So they went there with that brief. Because otherwise, yeah, you mention it, you got a lot of folks who are incumbents, but they won on this system and they don't really bring these type of bills to the floor.
I think you're seeing more and more candidates that are running on this issue, and a lot of them are discovering that this is sort of the sound check on the microphone when they stand in front of an audience. If they don't start by talking about the influence that big money is having on politics and on governing, then eyes glaze over. But if they start there, people say, hey, this guy knows how I feel, and maybe I should listen to the rest of what he needs to say. So I think you're going to increasingly see candidates grab hold of this. I do think it's important that we focus not just on the impact that big money has on the outcome of elections, but what happens with governing. Next Tuesday night and on Wednesday morning and the days thereafter, you're going to have a lot of pundits asking the question, did big money have an effect? Was big money successful in impacting the outcome of the elections? But the real story is that big money wins regardless of the outcome of the elections, because whether you're a Democrat or Republican candidate, if you're getting a lot of money from special interests, then when it comes time to govern in Washington, human nature says you're going to lean in that direction. Mm-hmm.
Congressman, is there a local model for the legislation that you're trying to get passed? I mean, for instance, here in New York City, there's a campaign finance law, and 49 of the 51 candidates who won participated in the local campaign finance program. So what, if any, model did you use for the legislation you've devised?
Well, New York City is a great example of that. I wanted to try to test drive what my bill says in my own district, actually in the 3rd District. We started something called the My Voice campaign, which is to empower everyday citizens to say my voice does count. And we set out to see if we could hit the threshold in the Government by the People Act for qualifying for public funding, which is to raise $50,000 from at least 1,000 small donors. We're going to do that by the end of this cycle and show that it's possible to build this kind of infrastructure that would allow you to access public financing under the model we've created, and to start giving a voice back to everyday citizens who feel so left out.
Let me ask you about that, because your bill focuses, and I think it's extremely important, focuses on the money that candidates themselves are raising. But we know outside money is starting to come in larger dollar amounts and actually be more important to races than even what the candidates are raising themselves. So can we really actually fundamentally shift the balance here without a constitutional amendment that says money is not speech?
Well, of course, a constitutional amendment is a very tough row to hoe. That's part of the containment strategy, which is putting limits on the amount of money that's spent in campaigns. This Supreme Court obviously has no interest in doing that. That's why we want to turn to the empowerment strategy, which is really competing for influence, but doing it on behalf of small donors. The other thing is, if you build out a small donor network, you can't totally solve for the problem of a super PAC coming after you, but you can partially solve for it, because if that super PAC comes for you, you've got a place to turn, and you can say to the $25 and $50 donors, I need your help now. Yeah. I need your help in the last stretch here, and you've got some recourse. If you don't have that network in place, you're basically left defenseless. So I think it makes sense to bring everyday citizens into this, because they'll have your back even in the face of those super PACs.
Yeah, it is such a problem, and so refreshing to have a politician speaking out about this. Congressman John Sarbanes, thank you so much for being with us. And up next, meet the billionaires that all of that money is coming from. And still ahead, gold fever takes over the cycle with Discovery's number one show, Gold Rush.